Mass spectrometry is a field in chemistry that basically studies and analyzes molecules by using their molecular mass. So an instrument known as the mass spectrometer allows us to actually calculate what our mass is of some unknown molecule, and it uses the principles of electric and magnetic fields. So basically, we take our molecule and we place that molecule into the mass spectrometer and we flip a switch. So once we flip that switch, we create a high voltage difference, and that high voltage difference creates an electric current that basically collides with our unknown sample and it ionizes it. It gives it a positive charge. And once the molecule develops a positive charge, that positive charge can be used to accelerate it through electric and magnetic fields. And eventually it collides into a region known as the ion detector. And the ion detector can basically calculate what the radius of curvature is of that particular molecule, and that can give us what the mass m is of our molecule. Now, if you don't know where this equation comes from, or you want to learn about the physics behind the mass spectrometer, go back and watch my lecture on mass spectrometers in the physics section. So let's suppose now we collect all the mass data. What exactly can we do? How can we analyze all this information that is collected by our mass spectrometer? So basically, we create something called the mass spectra of our molecule. So once the data is collected, it can be readily analyzed by creating the following graph known as the mass spectra. So the y-axis designates the relative abundance that depends on the intensity of our molecule, the ion, that is colliding with the ion detector, where the x-axis basically designates the mass per charge ratio. So m divided by q, where m is the molecular mass and q is the charge. Now, usually the charge of our ion is positive 1. And because m divided by positive 1, the charge, is simply equal to m, we see that the x-axis on the mass spectrum designates what the mass of our molecule is. So to see exactly how the mass spectrometer works and to analyze this mass spectrum more fully, let's take a look at the following example, in which we take a cyclohexane, we place that cyclohexane shown here into our mass spectrometer, and we allow it to accelerate through the mass spectrometer. So basically, initially, we place it inside, we flip a switch, that creates a high voltage difference, and that allows two electrons to travel with high velocities. That is, we create the electric current. Now, these electrons are traveling with high velocity, so they carry a great amount of kinetic energy. And when these electrons, high energy electrons, collide with the electrons of the molecule, they eject those electrons by giving them enough energy to overcome our nuclear forces, our electrostatic forces. Now, once those electrons are ejected, our ion, or our molecule, is ionized into an ion. Now, this molecule that we begin with is known as the parent molecule, and this ion created is known as the parent ion. Now, when our ion detector detects our parent ion, it can calculate what the mass of that ion is. And the way we designate it on this mass spectrograph is by using a line. Now, the height of the line designates the relative abundance, the intensity of our ion as it collides with the ion detector, where the x-axis designates what the mass of that ion is. So basically, if this peak or the spectral line, this line designates the line for our parent ion, then the peak is known as the parent peak and it's given by our lowercase letter p. Now notice that this is our parent peak and it corresponds to a mass of 84. Now this molecule consists of 6 carbons and 12 H atoms, and in fact our molecular mass of the cyclohexane is in fact 84. So once again, notice that the parent peak corresponds to the mass of 84, which corresponds to the mass of our cyclohexane. Now, what about the peak directly to the right of our parent peak? So if we go one peak to the right, we get the small peak. And this small peak is given a special name known as the P1 peak. Now, what exactly does, or the P+1 peak? So what exactly does this P+1 peak actually represent? What does it symbolize? Well, recall that in nature we have atoms of different isotopes. So we basically have the carbon atom, which contains different isotopes. We have the H atom, which also contains different isotopes. And we see that the P+1 peak, which is slightly heavier than our parent peak, basically designates our molecule, the cyclohexane, that contains one or more of our heavier isotopes. So once again, recall that atoms such as carbon and hydrogen have isotopes of varying mass, and the P+1 peak corresponds to the molecule of the cyclohexane that contains the heavier isotopes. So notice that the entire mass spectra doesn't only consist of the parent peak and the P+1 peak. It contains many other peaks as shown in this diagram. Now, this entire conglomerate of all these peaks is known as the fragmentation pattern. So once again, notice that the mass spectrographs do not simply consist of P and P+1 peaks. There are many other peaks formed that correspond to the lower weight molecules, and this is known as the fragmentation pattern. So once again, we have many of these other peaks, and these peaks have our masses that are much lower than the mass of the actual molecule. The question is, if we initially only input or place a molecule of cyclohexane into our mass spectrometer, how can we get other molecules with lower mass inside our mass spectrometer? So as it turns out, when we actually place that molecule inside our mass spectrometer and when we input the amount of energy given by delta E, sometimes it ionizes it into this parent ion, but other times <clears throat> it actually breaks it down into other molecules. That is, it creates other fragments of our cyclohexane. So once again, as it turns out, that as you actually input the energy to ionize the molecule, it can also undergo other reactions in which it fragments into lower mass molecules. And these lower mass molecules that have charge as well can be detected by our ion detector, and it can graph, as shown, these other peaks that correspond to these lower weight fragments. Now, if we examine this entire peak, we see that there exists a peak that is the highest, and this highest peak is called the base peak. So the highest peak, which may or may not correspond to the parent ion, is known as the base peak. And in this particular case, the highest peak shown here is not our parent peak. This is the parent peak, and this is our base peak. In fact, the way that we define the relative abundance is we take our peaks and we find the base peak, and we give that base peak a value of 100% abundance. And all these other peaks are basically compared relative to this highest peak, the base peak. So if this is 100%, this will be smaller than 100% of